Okay, good morning everyone. So just a quick announcement then about the project. A few people have just wanted a little bit of clarification regarding HAZOP. As noted in the last memo, there's HAZOP is done on the node that was allocated to your group, but that also just plays into a little bit about the intention of HAZOP. HAZOP, we look at the process and we investigate it for problems, and what we typically get from that is a number of improvements. One of the improvements is around SIS, and the other improvement that you would get from HAZOP is a decision around alarms. Okay, so what that plays into then is that where your SIS system should be shown in your work is around the node that you've done your HAZOP. I'm not expecting then SIS systems everywhere, because those SIS systems are only discovered from thoughtful HAZOPing of the process, which is a long, tedious approach. So typically, I'm only looking for SIS around your HAZOP unit and alarms as well. Now, alarms are not difficult to implement elsewhere, right? And I would expect that there would be some basic alarms that you would have added on other parts of your process. But by and large, I'm expecting SIS and alarms to appear on the node where your HAZOP is. Okay. Is that clear?
Yep. If we've already gone through and put SIS in other areas that are
that's quite okay. Yeah. Okay, so then secondly, there's this case study that we've been working on from Monday's class. That case study was handed out on Monday, and there's a second handout that follows on from that that's now in today's class. So we're continuing on with the case. If you missed Monday's class, you may find this class a little bit hard to catch up with. Please watch the videos. Please make sure that you get immersed in that case study. If there's anyone that needs a copy of the case study, yeah, okay. So can you just pass those back then? Okay. So let's just have a quick recap of what happened. By the way, this is the approach that what we're going to cover in today's class is required for the tutorial on Thursday and Friday. And you might also be sitting here and thinking, well, there's no way he can examine us on this. Right, but up to now you've noticed that nothing in here requires access to a plant or a process. So absolutely, this always does appear in an exam, and we do need to learn how to troubleshoot. It's only when you need to start doing plant experiments and asking questions of the plant that that becomes interactive. But up to now, we've simply just done a basic review of the process. And recall what happened here is we've got this material being fed from a tank. We have some amount of material going through a pump, being flowed, being measured at a particular flow, FC1, and it's entering a fired heater where that temperature of the material is being raised and it's leaving then at a higher temperature. What we had asked the operators to do is we needed to increase the flow, right? Our goal is to have greater production, so we increase that flow, and what we do when that happens is that flow increases. This temperature over here will initially, for a very short period, actually start to drop. In fact, this more realistically should be shown as merely a short blip in the temperature down. And when that deviation in temperature is picked up, the fuel, F2, there will start to increase. We need to increase our fuel to get that material heated so that we maintain the same temperature. The problem we experienced in the class on Monday and worked through a bit was we noticed that instead of that continuing on, when we raised the feed flow rate a second time, so we're staging this, gradually ramping up our flow there in red, we noticed that the second time fuel starts to increase as expected, but it just keeps on increasing. Right? And our temperature here, instead of staying constant, starts to drop off. So that's the problem we're facing. And we had gone through a number of approaches, a number of stages, I should say. Let's just quickly revise those. The first is to engage ourselves. So that is taking an active change in our emotions to calm ourselves, to deal with the fact that we have to solve this problem. And the link I posted to the air traffic controller shows that done quite effectively in a case that's far more dangerous than might be the one we're dealing with here. So engage yourself, and we discussed that in several ways last time, so we won't recap that. The next one is we define the problem. Okay, we looked at a number of points, and that's on that handout that you have in front of you. In the define stage, you ask yourself, what should be happening? What is actually happening? We've just gone through that over here. What should be happening versus what is actually happening? Define that deviation and define where you want to end up. So know where you want to land. Some of the other things to look at here is during the define stage is to figure out, or at least be clear in your mind, if this is happening during startup or is this happening during regular operation. It's very important to be aware of that. I didn't cover that last time, so just perhaps add to your notes, is this regular operation when things are a lot more clear-cut, or startup? Startup is an intentionally difficult time of a plant because so many things are changing. And diagnosing problems during startup, you're not clear if there's cause and effect due to the active changes being made during startup or if it's due to an actual problem. Also, when you've just cleaned out a plant and you're starting it up again, a number of things will go wrong, right? And so that's a really tough point in time to actually be troubleshooting is during that phase. And then we looked at last class, the explore step. We spent the rest of the class on the explore step, and it's a critical step that as engineers we often jump over because we think we have all these ideas in our mind of what should be happening. We're pretty knowledgeable about our process, and so we don't feel the need to actively explore the problem. And I gave a number of ways that you might do that to slow yourself down is ask yourself what fundamentals apply, right? And when I talk about that, I mean, we looked at mass and energy balances might apply, thermo might apply, chemistry, physics, reactor design concepts might apply. Do process control concepts apply? Okay. Heat transfer, fluid flow. Look back at all the fundamental topics that you've learned about over the years. In most examples that you troubleshoot, you'll see at least several of these topics coming into play, right? And that's why this is a difficult skill to learn, because we're used to being solving problems that are very academic. Like, here's a thermodynamics problem. Here's a fluid flow problem. We never start to see the intersection of these areas come together. And we'll see that here in this problem. Again, it's not just one topic that could apply. So we went through that last time. We looked at some concepts from those various regions. Last time, you'll also recall, we did a cause and effect analysis. Okay, so we know that this temperature is dropping. That's the effect. And we see, the temperature is dropping and this fuel is rising. So two effects. What could be the cause of that? Right, the hardest problems to solve are these where you're going from the symptoms back to the causes. By the end of this class today, I'll show you that this set of symptoms we're seeing here will have a list of about 8 or 10 different causes that could be the cause of the problem. One of them will be the actual cause, which we'll try and discover. But what that indicates to you is that if that same problem occurred 2 weeks from now, it could be an entirely different cause, right? And we're always in this habit instinctively as humans that if we see the same set of conditions, we say, aha, I know what that is, it was this. But what we're going to learn today is there's multiple causes for the same set of symptoms. And that's why doctors have such a tough time, right? They're presented with patients with symptoms. There's multiple causes that could be the issue. And how do we rule that out is what we're trying to solve here. And then we ended off last class by saying, let's check our information. Okay, and I gave you several ways that you could do that. One way is, of course, that we need some consistency in our flows. Right, let's take a look at this. If I'm measuring flow over here, FC1, is there another flow on that diagram that should try to match it? That should agree with it?
Yep.
F7, okay. So there should be relationship with some time delay between F1 and F7, right? We looked at another example I gave last class was heat exchangers. Heat exchangers require a certain consistency in the temperature values coming in and out of the heat exchangers. Pressure differences across a plant from beginning to end must also match the expectation that there's higher pressures at the beginning and then lower and lower pressures as you go down. And so that checking then will become very instinctive as an engineer. Okay, so we've looked then, I'll just resume here, we've say FC1 and F7 should agree. Anything else that should agree or have some expected values that we could use?
TC1 and T4.
TC1 and T4 should agree. Okay, anything else that we might look at? Are the trends and changes over time?
There should be like an increase in FC5, the airflow, as you increase your fuel for the furnace.
Okay, should be an increase in the airflow as we put in more fuel. Though not explicitly shown here, there's no controller that does that. Okay. Anything else that we should see? Levels, temperatures, flows. Yeah.
Should be an increase from T5 to T6.
T5 to T6. Right. Okay. So T5 is over here. Okay. So T5. We should see T5 being smaller than T6. And T6 and T4 should obey similar sequence, okay? And that we're using this to tell us, remember, our sensors never are honest. Our sensors are always lying, so we're using that consistency check there for us. P3 is the pressure inside the furnace. No, not necessarily. It's there's a piece here that I've omitted to draw, a small damper. I forgot the damper. The damper is an angling device, and so P3 will change with the angle of the damper, but that's constant, or should be constant. Okay, we should see level L1 here in the tank. There's a level L1 should be dropping. Okay, and the fuel flow F2 and the airflow FC5, they should be consistent with prior operation when we were operating at this FC1. So this will be a little bit of a harder check to go do. You have to go back to your records and see when you operated at this higher flow, whether the fuel and the air flows matched. Okay, L1 should be dropping at the rate used. Okay, right, so cross-check that. Okay, so make sure that there's not a... You could use that knowledge then to verify if there's a leak in the tank or somewhere. Okay, so it's very easy to check our information using... Back to our fundamentals. We're looking for trends in the data. L1 dropping is a trend in the data. Another trend that we notice, of course, is that F2 is rising rapidly and T1 is dropping. So when we can ask ourselves some trends, and there's one of them. Other trends we notice then are F2 drop and TC1 rises. Okay, notice that this is stating the obvious, but it's slowing you down a little bit, right? It's just you're verbalizing this as you're going through the process to make sure that you have actually caught all the necessary information. And then the other thing that we will do is we'll try to separate opinions from facts. Okay, so if you look in that description there, the operator said she believes it's the stack damper that's at fault. She might, that's a valid conclusion to come to, because if you open this too much, you're allowing material to flow, the gases to vent out, so TC1 would drop. The operator has this opinion stated in the handout that that's the case. Okay. There was also an opinion stated that there was a smell of fuel, that someone could smell that. That's, again, an opinion. Yeah.
For the trans, should this be the opposite?
Oh, sorry. Thanks. Okay, so check opinions, check facts, and you're always going to see this when you troubleshoot. Everyone says, I know what's wrong, I know what's wrong. Everyone's got their opinion, and we're trying to sort through that. No different to when you're going to the doctor. You often come with your opinion of what's wrong with you, right? And the doctor's now got it. That's one extra data point the doctor has to sift through to try and come to a diagnosis. The other thing that we'll also look at is ask ourselves if there's any recent changes. Okay, now this one is very tempting to fall into this, because we say, well, if I recently changed something and something bad just happened, well, let me just undo what I changed and I'll go back to normal. Right? It's a very, very tempting thing as well, because it seems to be cause and effect. You change something, and then the effect happens. Something bad has happened. So you know you've got this sort of cause and effect built up. But it's not always so clear cut. There's many changes on a chemical process that are of longer term. So things like fouling or corrosion. Okay, so classic examples are pieces of metal inside a tank that have been corroding over time, and then one day they break off and they get lodged in the impeller, and it causes the impeller to get stuck. That's the true cause and effect, but someone else looking at the data will find some other reason. Right? We'll even see this from a statistical point of view. If you look at data from a chemical plant, there's about 200-300 variables that you can often get from a process. You'll almost always find a change in the trends of a data to match with something else in the process. Right? It doesn't guarantee cause and effect. Just when you have so much data available to you, everything now suddenly becomes a seeming cause when it's not really. Okay, so we really actually have a harder job these days than someone 20, 30 years ago with less data available to them. Because you're going to go look at your data, and you're going to find other data, other trends in your data historian that will show a similar change at the same time, and you're going to say, that's the problem, right? It's just, but that's not cause and effect. That's only a correlation in the data. Okay, so that's explore. Now let's get to the real task of trying to diagnose this problem. So we're moving into stage four, and here's where I'm going to ask you to spend a little bit of time and do some brainstorming. Now, be careful. You're going to brainstorm ideas and sort of try to screen yourself and prejudge the conditions. Let's be careful of doing that. When we brainstorm, we're brainstorming ideas that are plausible, and then we're going to do experiments to try and rule them out. So what we want is some root causes. You've got that sheet in front of you. The new handout that you have. That's got empty spaces on it. Okay, and it says working hypothesis from brainstorming. So I'd like you to take a few minutes and fill in that sheet. There's 9 or 10 spaces for you to fill in potential causes. I filled in one, the one from the operator. The operator has suggested that the stack damper has opened too far. Okay. Suggest a few others. Take 3-4 minutes. I'll give you a chance. Work with the person next to you and suggest other root causes that could have led to this problem. I don't want you to think too hard about whether those are true causes. But what other ways could you have had that temperature drop and that fuel rate rise. Okay, big discussion needs to be going on here. Okay, so you should be able to brainstorm at least 4 or 5 potential root causes that you want to go investigate next. So someone suggested the stack damper open. Talk about, I'll give you another minute or so, other causes for this problem. Okay, let's some suggestions perhaps of root causes. Devin? The airflow is okay. Okay, so if the valve is fully open, we're going to see. Okay, so let's, if I reword your suggestion as airflow is too low, okay. Okay, other suggestions, Nicole? A leak in the fuel pipe after the valve. Okay, so after FC1. Okay, fuel, I see. Okay, so leaking fuel after F2. Okay, yeah.
FC1 was improperly calibrated.
FC1 badly calibrated. Let me also maybe add to that, that valve is broken. So something around that valve control loop, badly calibrated valve broken. Okay, so we switched to the wrong feed tank. Okay, anything related to the temperature TC1, why would it drop? Okay, so TC1 broken. Maybe let's explore that. It's a control loop. It could be going, it's oscillating, it's badly tuned, it's something around that control loop that's poor. So TC1 broken. Let's look at tuning or unstable. Oscillations, perhaps. Okay, yeah. V300 is blocked. Oh, okay. The fuel valve, V300, so fuel valve is blocked. FC1 leak. So leak in fuel after F2, I'm going to maybe, just because of space, group similar ones together. So leak in fuel valve or broken fuel valve. Okay. TR. Okay, fouling in the pipes that affect heat transfer. We can expand on that, anything that would reduce heat transfer, whether it's fouling, whether it's something that's blocked the path of the flame and the radiation onto the pipes. Okay, so fouling, so the primary form of heat transfer here is radiation, and so anything that would block that radiation from occurring. Okay, so TC1 unstable tuning controller. Okay, I just want to add another one here. This is going to get messy. So just maybe expand on the suggestion from Michelle about the control loop over there. So 7 is fouling and bad radiation. 8 is then TC1 is badly, is broken. Okay, so remember it's a controller or thermocouple is broken. Oh, it's there already, sorry. Okay, so if the thermocouple is broken, one thing to bear in mind, the way these thermocouples work, it's the junction of the metal, right? And so if that breaks apart, then that will break that control loop. The other thing to bear in mind is that thermocouple isn't directly in contact with the fluid. Typically, there's a casing into the pipe, right? And so if an operator or someone from calibration takes the thermocouple out, you don't just suddenly have fluid spewing everywhere. So you take the thermocouple out for calibration, and while they're holding it out there in the air, you'd see TC1 drop like that. Right? So you've taken your thermocouple out of the stream that you're measuring, and that's going to start to cool down. Okay, so all of these are seemingly reasonable root causes. Now, I would like to show you how we can work through this in a systematic way to try and eliminate them. And we've got three pieces of evidence right now, and we're going to add more evidence we're going to either try and support the hypothesis, the root cause, or we're going to try and disprove it in some way. Okay, so let's take a look here at the first one. If the stack damper is open, the fact that we've increased the fuel, the feed, FC1, has no bearing on the stack damper. Okay, so that's a neutral piece of evidence. So it's not going to support that. It's not going to support it or disprove it, so it's neutral. If the TC1, we see TC1 dropping, could that have been caused by the stack damper being open? Okay, so that's supportive of that particular hypothesis. We don't have evidence yet to rule it out. The fuel increasing, F2. Yes, that also supports it, because if we're seeing a drop in temperature, that control loop up there, this drop in temperature is being observed, that control loop will serve to open the fuel. So that stack damper is fully open, temperature will drop, fuel will open. So far that supports that conclusion there. Okay, airflow rate too low. Let's take a look. If the airflow coming in FC5 is too low, that has no bearing on the feed. The feed is not going to be affected by that. But if the airflow is too low, would we see TC1 drop? Yes, okay. So that's supportive of that. Would we see the fuel increasing? Yes, for the same reason as before, we've got a feedback control loop in there. Okay, a leak or broken fuel after F2. So a broken fuel valve. So again, feed has no bearing on that, the FC1. TC1 will drop rapidly. Is that supported by that? Yes. And fuel increasing? Even more so. So that control system will kick in. FC1 badly calibrated, or the valve broken. So the feed valve is broken. Okay. If the feed valve control loop is badly calibrated, or that valve is broken, would we see the feed being increased? No? Okay, it depends, I guess, where it breaks. If that sensor is there measuring the feed, if we see the valve breaking there, we're still going to read a flow. Okay. So here I would say it's neutral. It's certainly not disproving it. We can't rule that out as the cause just yet. And if that feed was broken, would we see the temperature drop rapidly? Yes, and we would see the fuel increasing. So far we've not been able to rule out any of these root causes based on our evidence seen so far. Okay, the wrong feed tank, again, the same idea. If we were feeding the wrong material to the tank, what would be one way that we could, I'm just thinking ahead here, how would you verify that if you try to rule out that as a root cause? If you were using the wrong feed tank, what would you see happening? Right, the next step that we're going to look at is diagnostics. We're going to try and do experiments. What would you go ask the plant to do or verify?
You'd like look at the products from your reactor and see if they were matching with
you. Okay, so yeah, if we're using the wrong feed tank, this is point number 5. I'm going to put it over here. To try and rule out number 5, you would check your products. Okay. The easiest way to do it, I don't have it drawn here, is to check L2, the level in the product tank. Right, if that level was rising, then you're actually successfully making product. And that would be a way to rule out that conclusion. Okay. TC1 is broken, unstable, or has oscillations. Again, that's not going to be affected by the feed increase. The TC1 dropping rapidly, that would certainly happen. and the fuel flow would increase. Okay, so far we don't seem to have very good evidence to rule out any of our root causes. Bad fouling, radiation. Again, all the evidence can support that. So here, I'm hoping you're starting to see why doctors have such a hard time, why troubleshooting is so difficult. We've got 7 fairly plausible root causes. None of these are unrealistic, right? No one's saying anything that's beyond reasonable expectation. And with these 3 pieces of evidence that we have, we've not been able to rule any of it out. Okay? So 7 different root causes for the same set of symptoms. Now let's try to work through this a bit. One of the ways we can do that is to request more information from our client, right? And this is what you were doing in the troubleshooting tutorial. So the fact that TC1 and T4 are consistent, so T1 and TC4 match. Okay, so in the troubleshooting tutorial, you would ask, does T4 match TC1? And the expert system says, yes, they're in agreement. What does that rule out? It rules out, let's be careful, it rules out part of number 6. It rules out that TC1 is broken. Okay, but it doesn't mean that that control loop is necessarily tuned well. Okay, that disproves part of it. So that's normally I would have written those out in 2 lines, but so it disproves part 1. It doesn't do anything. It's neutral for part 2. Okay. Let's take a look at another piece of evidence we had asked for earlier, the suggestion that FC1 and F7 agree. So FC1 and F7 match up. What is there that we can do with that? Okay, so it rules out that FC1 is broken. Okay, it might be badly calibrated and giving you the wrong value. Well, no, actually, it would even rule out the badly calibrated, right? Because if FC1 and F7 match, then that F1, that basically says that whatever we're controlling there at that valve is as we expect. Okay, so this is disproved. I'm going to just put a little 4 in there so you can match it up here in case these I don't write so well. We're adding pieces of evidence. So we've got these 3 pieces of evidence initially. Now we've asked more evidence, right? Or we've observed ourselves, or we've asked the plant, the expert system, T1 and T4 match. So that allows us to eliminate some of these problems. The fact that FC1 and F7 match means that it's not the flow controller one that's causing the problem anymore.
So those things
that are true. So it basically means that we can rule out this as a potential problem. Right? So we've ruled out that root cause. So we've still got 6 other root causes left. Okay, so what can we do next? Okay, so here's a suggestion. Check P3. Now, tomorrow and Friday, when you're the expert system and the troubleshooter says check P3, what is your answer? The sensor is there, right? You need to be, when you're asking questions of the plant, let's be a little bit more specific. So check P3 is at set point, above set point, below set point. The reason why I want you to think of this is, imagine that you're not doing this work, but that you're sending a co-op student out there to do it for you. Okay? You need to be at that level of detail for them to follow your instructions. So even if you asked an operator and said, the operator, check P3, the operator's like, what do you want me to check? Well, P3, let's check P3 is at set point. Okay, and let's imagine that we can do that very quickly. We can go to the control room and check P3 is at set point, and it's where it should be, and so that disproves that hypothesis or that root cause. Okay, let's look at the broken fuel after F2. That's a dangerous one to go check, right? The only way we can, is there some other way we can check it? Doesn't seem to be, right? We're saying that F2 is flowing, but there's some breakage over here, right? And the only way to verify that would be an actual trip out to the plant. Okay? Now, this is a good piece of advice that's often mentioned, is that one way to troubleshoot is to actually, no one successfully troubleshoots from behind their desk. The only way to successfully troubleshoot is at the site and being right there at the operator's desk or at the physical equipment itself. And so we could go verify that breakage there and rule out that problem. So I'm going to rule that out because I'm the expert system. I'm saying that that's not the issue. We go out, if you asked me as the expert system in tomorrow's tutorial, I would tell you there's no observable fuel leak. While I'm out there, I might as well check some other things. I will also check FC1 and tell you that that's not the issue. Okay, so. We didn't disprove the, we said it wasn't calibrated. The valve may have, there might have been, oh, sorry, yes, we did disprove it. Yeah, sorry, okay, my mistake. I would also go check the connection for the feed tank, or I would go do this step here, check the products, okay, or check L2 is rising. And I'm going to go verify those for you, and I'll tell you that the products are okay, the level 2 is rising, and so we can eliminate that as a root cause. Okay, so now we're left with airflow too low, the control loop that's being unstable, or bad radiation. Okay, fouling, bad radiation. This one, is there a practical way I can check that? Okay, I certainly can't go right up to the fired heater and look inside it to see that. Okay, so that's something right now that's beyond my level of diagnosing and troubleshooting. Okay, so this goes, it's a potential cause, but it's going down the list in terms of something that we can take action on. I can't go easily do that right now. Yeah.
Can you do like an energy balance around like the amount of fuel you're combusting and the heat transfer into the
okay.
heat and see like if the efficiency of the furnace has dropped? And if it has significantly, then you can chalk it up to that maybe.
Okay, that's a great suggestion. So doing an energy balance around the heater, comparing fuel flow rates in, heat leaving in your streams, and then comparing that to historical operation. Okay, so that's a great way to verify if there's been a sudden change due to some blockage in the system, or if it's a slow deviation over time, it's indicating gradual fouling. Gradual fouling is likely not the cause for what we've observed over here, because we seem to be operating well, and then suddenly we're not. Okay, so it's unlikely that it's a slow-moving change that's caused the problem. It needed to have been something that's sudden. So was it something that suddenly fell into the path of the flame? Could well be. Okay, and that we can check that. Okay, so let's say you went for a few minutes and you did some of that calculation, and we'll rule it out. Okay, now we're down to two root causes: airflow being too low, and the tuning and unstable oscillations. Control loops. How can we troubleshoot control loops? Make a step change. Okay. If we're making a step change, we're putting the control loop in manual. So put TC1 in manual. Now, let's take a look at what's happening here so far. I'll show you, I'll do this experiment for you and give you the data. So what we've observed so far is TC1 So here's TC1. That's where we are right now. Okay. And at this point in time, we're going to put the control loop in manual. And what manual does, the moment you flick that switch, it holds the manipulated variable where it is. Right? And we're going to observe that response. So let's plot this again here. The manipulated variable is fuel, F2. And what we observed there with F2 is a rise in that, and then now we're rising uncontrollably. Okay, and so the moment you put that control loop in manual, we start to do that. We're not varying that anymore. We're not closing that loop. And what happens then is we observe this. You've done that experiment. What do we learn from that? Not too much, but Runzi suggested we do a step change. Okay, which way do you want to step?
Up.
Just keep it up. Okay. Do you want to do another step? What do you start to, what's the, you thinking is happening here? Okay, Mark is suggesting the fuel's not combusting. Alex?
Is the actual feed stream heating the fuel, like the burning fuel?
Sorry, which feed stream? Okay, yeah. Is it being
heated?
Oh, the other way around? No, that's not likely to happen in a fired heater. Yeah.
What if you do a step down?
Okay, what if we do a step down? Okay, Runzi is suggesting there's something wrong with the tuning. Yeah.
Is it possible that the response just isn't linear, so like the controller can't tune for like a higher value?
Okay, the response is not linear and the controller is not able to work at this higher level, higher value of flow. Okay, so there's a number of suggestions here. Sorry? The tuning is backwards. Okay, what should the tuning be? Positive gain, right? If you increase the fuel flow, you should see an increase in temperature. Right, but why did we didn't have that over here because the control loop was in automatic. Right, so remember I said controllers always will undo and reverse the way the normal things work. And now we're in manual, so now we've got Now, the nice thing of putting a control loop in manual is you get true cause and effect. So we're seeing this cause and the corresponding effect. OK. Okay, I want you to think a little bit more about that. You're all on the right track. The controller gain is the wrong sign. That's correct. But controller gains don't just suddenly flip sign. Okay, what's gone on there a bit? I'm not going to tell you the answer just yet. Okay, so think a bit more about it, and then we'll talk about it on Friday and collect some ideas.